Hey guys, welcome to the Archon Team League Tournament. I'm joined today by Noxious and Ecop. How you guys doing?
I'm doing great as usual. So kind of nice to cast with you again. It's been a while.
Yeah. How about yourself, Ecop? Coming back for some vacation time?
Yeah, I had some time off Hearthstone. I took like a week vacation in Italy and it's been refreshing. I've come here, did my research for this casting session, and I'm prepared to like give it my all, give it my best.
All right, well, that sounds pretty sick. We are going to have Foursome Boys facing off against Team Celestial. It's basically a last chance for Team Celestial. If we take a look at the standings, we kind of get the image of what's happening. Foursome Boys, kind of still middle of the pack, you know, 3-2, 2-3. You know, that's still anyone's game, but Team Celestial 0-5, this being the second last week. I believe they have to beat Foursome Boys and win again next week. And then Foursome Boys has to lose again next week.
Yeah, the Team Liquid, I believe. I think Ecop knows the exact way this has to go down. So it is Team Liquid they have to lose against, right?
Yeah, so basically the story is this. Team Celestial is in a must-win situation as of this point. This is probably the most important match for them. If they lose this, they're eliminated. Clear cut. But so what the Team Celestial needs to do is they have to win this week, they have to win next week, and then they have to hope that either Team Liquid or Foursome Boys stumble and go 0-2 in this week and next week. So this is actually a likely scenario. Let's say Team Liquid and Foursome Boys both lose this week. I mean, Foursome Boys might lose to Celestial and Team Liquid loses to Value Town. And the next week, Team Liquid is actually playing versus Foursome Boys. So if both of those teams lost, then one of them will be in a 2-5 score, which might be the same score that Celestial could have if they win both their matches. Yeah. So Celestial, even though it looks like they're out, they still have a chance, and it's actually more realistic than you might think.
Go China.
Yeah, I don't know if I agree with that last statement. They do have a chance, but I don't know how realistic it is. As you mentioned in your summary, you're absolutely correct. They are in a must-win situation, but it's not a must-win situation. It's a must-dominate situation. Right. They have to like absolutely wreck Foursome Boys this week to really stand any chance. So we'll have to see if that happens. Again, guys, if you guys are watching the Archon Team League for the first time, it is going to be a pretty epic best of 11 team on team. You guys will see how it happens as it rolls out. Each player bringing two decks and conquest. Sometimes one player gets the short end of the stick at the end, but sometimes watching people get really miserable in Hearthstone is a pretty enjoyable experience for the viewer. So there's that.
That's what I watch Hearthstone for. People think I cast because I actually understand the game. What I really just like is looking at facial reactions from Savice when he doesn't get what he needs. That's what I do it for.
Well, all right, guys. We will hop into the games pretty soon. But before that, to follow our typical casting format, we have an extremely special, super cool player/caster spotlight on me.
Hey guys, I'm Crip. I stream, I do YouTube content, I like to push out ideas on Reddit, on Twitter, and all the crazy stuff that happens in the game is really what fascinates me, and I try to give that craziness back with the content that I make. I do a lot of casting, I do a lot of playing Arena, most of the funsy modes, and I enjoy the fun in Hearthstone. The secret to being a good caster, well, there's many different type of casters, and I think each different type, like there's many great casters as far as people see them at least. I think I'm kind of like a hybrid funny, because I'm not really funny, just like a little bit by accident most of the time. And then there's the analytical caster, which I'm not exactly that either. So I'm the in-betweener. I'm kind of funny and kind of analytical. And maybe that fits a good enough spot so people like me. Starting a career in esports, well, you definitely need one very distinctive feature to stand out, because as it so happens, most people like playing video games, and they do that a lot. So you're competing with everyone, basically. So you have to be amazingly funny. You have to have maybe good presentation communication skills, or maybe you can just be ridiculously good at the game, and then you don't need anything else, really. Sometimes people do pretty well creating very polished content, so if you're really not too good at anything, maybe consider going to school for like video editing and production, that kind of stuff, and maybe you can push your own content, and the quality of the content makes you stand out from everyone else. So the format is pretty amazing here in Archon's tournament. With players working together, I don't really know what kind of strategy they'll have with the decks because there's so many decks, but one thing that I think we can quite safely predict is the ability of the players to communicate ideas amongst each other. So some of the teams I think are a little bit at a disadvantage, like Forsen Boys, even though some of these guys, you know, they're amazing player by themselves, their ability to communicate together is like a random factor, where we know in some teams, especially the ones that are complete, let's say, already have this attribute to them. So I expect them to have a more consistent team strategy than the, let's call them makeshift teams. So, I mean, that's not really an advantage you can, you know, balance out in this type of tournament, but I will be really happy to see some of the underdogs win. Well, I hope you little Crypt dudes that like watching the Crypt are gonna go check out Crypt Cass's tournament, because it should be pretty cool. It's a cool format, and I really like the tournaments that have the cool format plus the competitive aspect. And with a lot of money on the line, the competitive aspect is really going to maybe, you know, crush the fun aspect. But we'll see, we'll see. I like the wild stuff, and this is the wild stuff, so. Hope it's going to be a good show, and you guys enjoy watching me cast it. Tune in to the Archon Team League Championships.
Welcome back, guys. Hope you guys enjoyed my player spotlight. Before we get into the games, I've got to thank our sponsors for making these events happen, for giving you guys this awesome viewing experience, and holy cow, those eyes. Big shout outs to Alpha Draft and the Amazon App Store. They are running a few promotions we'll talk about in a second, or in a while. Let's see who's about to play. We got Forsen Boys versus Team Celestial. Who are these guys?
Yeah, well, Forsen Boys, I think, is like, it's one of the two teams that we, as we mentioned during the break, is like one of those makeshift teams. Valuetown and Forsen Boys both are exactly that. Forsen Boys, though, initially started really well off. You know, they got wins on their first 2 weeks, and then it's just been disastrous from then on. We were talking to Shocky about that last week. They've been, you know, having a little bit of a rough time with three losses back-to-back. They kind of want to win it today, if only to deny the possibility that Celestial can come back, so we'll see exactly how that pans out.
Yeah, definitely. Forsen Boys have been on kind of a dry spell after a very strong start. And this, I don't know, this momentum, this negative momentum might eventually be the deciding factor what might give Team Celestial the victory here. Team Celestial, of course, the Asian presence in the Archon Team League, spearheaded by, of course, one of the best players in the world, the best player in Asia, arguably, Tiller Celestial, and his teammates Frozen Ice and Silent Storm. The team formed before the Archon Team League started, and definitely they are a force to be reckoned with in everyone's mind. But unfortunately, they haven't been performing as well as everyone expected them to.
Yeah, the results are not quite there. As it stands right now, I believe Frozen Ice is the player with the worst record in the tournament so far, with 4 wins and 15 losses, and a lot of his teammates not doing much better. Looks like we're going to kick off the tournament with Chalky on Hunter versus Silent Storm on Druid.
Yeah, Sunstorm is probably the most consistent player on Team Celestial. All through the tournament, I think. Starting on the first week, he got 2-0 in the first week, second week as well. And he's just been very consistent, whereas I think Tiddler and Frozen Eyes have had a much rougher time. And I have to wonder whether or not it has to do with the fact that they play more on the Asian servers and the metagame that they're used to is a bit different, or whether it's just a happenstance in this game.
You an esports fan? Prove
yourself. Yeah, I definitely agree. Silent Storm has been kind of the horse that has been carrying Team Celestial, or at least attempted to, with this 62% win rate, pretty decent. But compared to like Tiddler, Celestial, and Frozen Ice, who both have like the worst and second worst win rate in the league right now, it's been rather rough. And Tiddler, Celestial has brought like mage decks that are, I don't know, he brought like minion based mage decks as the only player in the Archon League, so I wonder what's up with that. Maybe that's also one of those reasons why Team Celestial has not been performing that well.
Yeah.
Now, on a personal note, I have to say that I've actually never cast Team Celestial game yet. Maybe I'm what's missing as part of this equation here, you know?
Yeah, right. Let's assume that's the case. Well, I don't know if you're going to try to make them more miserable because you enjoy the suffering, or if you're actually going to help them out.
Oh, speaking of suffering, that's a pretty nice freeze trap.
Yeah, it looks pretty good. I mean, it's pretty much one of the better starts for Druid. It's just it's one of those times where when you get the early Innervate plays, it prevents you from doing any decent follow-ups because you've used up your coin and the Innervate when you start it off like that, and you're very vulnerable to freezing trap in a case like this.
Yeah, well, the Wild Growth draw kind of makes the hand quite a bit better. Still, though, you're pretty sad here. I'm still curious on this like notion of a bit sadness here. Like, your team is 0-5, while almost every team is 3-2 or 2-3 in a team based tournament. And I know that in the past, team based formats have been like, you know, they have high highs, but they have very demoralizing lows. So yeah. Now we've seen Hearthstone grow to a pretty spectacular esport since those times, but I still feel that even though generally players don't play emotionally, I feel like that may play some factor in all this. What do you think, Ikop? You've kind of been around during all these times.
What do you mean by emotionally?
Maybe you don't care as much, maybe you don't prepare as much as you could, maybe you don't work together as well because of frustrations between the team.
Yeah, I mean, of course, it's something, like, this is the beauty of this format, of this team-based format. It's like RDU once said, that you really want to step up your game on every level, basically, because not only do you have to carry your own weight, but you also have your teammates relying on you. So you don't want to be like the player that drags your team down. So everyone is like trying to perform at 100% or 110% even.
Mm-hmm.
So I really enjoy that about this tournament, like everyone stepping up their game.
Yeah, it's actually one of the reasons why Team Archon decided ultimately to organize something along those lines, because it really hasn't been done exactly this way before, and not on such a scale at least. So it makes for, there was an article on Gosu Gamers that said, is Archon Team League the best thing that has ever happened to Hearthstone? And I almost want to agree at this point, because I don't think I've ever had as much fun watching a tournament that has, like, competitive decks in it.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, Chucky's still not doing too bad. It seems like the Druid had a pretty exceptional hand, but overall, the Hunter has just had very good answers all throughout so far.
Yeah, I was actually surprised that the Druid was able to come back so well, because I thought after the Freezing Trap on the Shredder, even with Wild Growth, you'd still be off tempo-wise if the Hunter gets anything relevant, and he's been able to stick around, so not bad at all.
Yeah, looks like he's favoring the Ragnaros here. That's an interesting one. You can even cycle Wrath if you want, but you probably don't want to do that.
Oh, the Ragnaros is such a huge clock when it enters the board. It's like one of the best win conditions, actually, to beat a Hunter often enough. If you just hide behind defensive minions like Taunters, Druid of the Claw, Sludge Belcher, then Ragnaros by itself might be a win condition already.
Yeah. And Wrath is going to do just fine here. You can even consider healing, I'd imagine. Like, Ragnaros is not dying.
Yeah, I'd probably heal myself. Yeah, with a board like this, it looks a little too dangerous not to. Nico?
Yeah, now it doesn't really matter what Ragnaros hits. Of course, you'd rather hit... You either want to hit face or the Lothepier, and the face is the place.
Wow.
As the more crack.
Oh my god.
What can even be done here?
I mean, you have to answer that. Okay, wait, you silence Rag, and then you attack with the mad scientist, get freezing trap, trade into the 5-5, and Rag can't attack anymore.
Yeah, we'll have to see.
That's pretty creative.
What kind of trap Chucky has?
If you do that, don't you like automatically lose the Druid of the Claw or Force of Nature?
Yeah, you die to a lot of stuff.
Yeah, a lot of stuff.
literally a lot of stuff. There's almost nothing that could save you.
Fortunately, Chucky, I think, came up with a much better play here of developing a bigger board, pushing for a considerable amount of damage.
What was the trap, by the way? I missed it.
Snake trap. Okay. Snake. So not hero powering here, especially because he needs as many minions on the board as possible, so Rag has the lowest chance possible to hit phase there.
He's going to have to... Like, if he finds another Wrath or Keeper of the Grove, he's going to be in pretty good shape. Oh well. Even Swipe would have been okay. Actually, Swipe would have been almost the best, probably, even.
So, 25% win?
Ooh, that's a pretty good hit. That kind of flushes out most lethal options. And Chalky's again in a position where he has to control the board a little bit, or well, he doesn't. I guess he can just go face again.
I mean, it's kind of the only way to win, right? Is you push face and you hope the Druid has nothing and never hits your face with a Rag. So you hope that he can't clear your board. You hope that he doesn't have a way to silence Rag, yeah, to attacking through your face because you're still dead. No Swipe, nothing, basically.
Oh, that is nothing.
Well, but there's healing, so that will give Sidestorm.
Yeah, there is healing, but is that really enough? 8-10. Yeah, it puts Sidestorm 2 out of lethal range. Well, I guess a little bit more because Rag has to hit something.
Yeah.
So there's a chance of...
Yeah,
there a chance of Chucky wins? So what has to die
kill
here?
Command. Not the Beast and top deck Kill Command.
Does that whoa, that doesn't...
That's enough. Wow. Oh my god. Leok damage.
No way, Leok. Leok was the play.
Exactly.
Leok value is truly
Wow,
insane.
This is unreal. I never thought I'd say that, but Leok actually won Chucky the game instead of a Huffer. This is insane. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, that's really only the case when you see an Unleash, but that was truly an exceptional case there. So Foursome Boys gets the first point on the board. Again, we mentioned going into this matchup that not only does Team Celestial need to win to not be eliminated basically on the spot today, they need to crush Foursome Boys. So normally a one-point advantage is not really...
Yeah, they have to crush Foursome Boys to get the game wins advantage.
Not only do they have to crush Foursome Boys, they also have to crush their next week's opponent, and this will be a tough task because Celestial is far, far behind in terms of point difference.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like in the league so far, we haven't really seen any sweeps. Like we've seen, I think, only one that came close to a sweep, and that was last week with Temple Storm versus Team Liquid. So I don't expect to see anything like this again. It's like that rare occurrence because all those players are so high level. You expect them to perform, you know, almost on equilibrium point.
Now, one aspect of the tournament that we haven't really talked about is the bench rule. So Silentstorm did lose a game, and whenever a player loses two consecutive games, they cannot play another one to follow. So what I'm kind of interested in, I don't think they can play one until someone on the team wins again, I believe, is the bench rule. So this is something I always ask, like, the guest caster. What do you think of this, Ecop? Is it worth the risk to kind of surprise people with Silentstorm? Or do you think it's predictable that Silentstorm won't go into the next match and you can not have to be worried about his decks? Like, what's the mind games here? This is where the mind games start playing in.
Yeah, I feel like at this stage, though, at the early stage of the match, it doesn't really matter all that much because you cannot go for the hard counters with this many decks still available. But later, the later the match progresses, the more effective the benching actually becomes for a team that has benched someone. And it's really tough to say. You can also mind game someone pretty hard if you, your opponent if your opponent expects you to not to go for a benched play for a player that might be benched, then you might surprise them by putting that player into action.
Yeah, I think it's I'll go along with Ecop say at this point it's a little bit of a toss-up. I think a lot of guest casters actually say that. A lot of the players that we've invited to cast tend to say mm-hmm. that early on it doesn't matter as much. But that if you can detect a pattern in your opponent's play, then maybe you'll have a way to exploit it a bit. Hence why RDU is so hell-bent on, you know, switching the strategies every week, I think, pretty much.
Yeah, mixing up just has a lot of value, I guess. Being unpredictable gives you that little bit of an edge. And I haven't seen a consistent strategy from all the players. I think more than likely, so far at least, people have played against having to bench someone early on. But I think it's been very slight as well. So not too big of a deal.
Yeah. By the way, Ecop, you play in the league, so you're probably doing a lot of match analysis. My question to you is, do you expect these two majors, to be freeze mages? Or do you think we'll see maybe a control mage? Because it looks to me like the deck is getting refined a bit more and has a lot, you know, more targeted matchups than it used to.
Well, freeze mage is definitely always a viable contender. There's based on the format, basically, because there's so many decks that you have to play, so Freeze Mage will always have like a good matchup at some point. Freeze Mage is definitely a safe choice, and it has been performing well. Minion-based mages, though, like Flamebreaker Mage or Mech Mage, that Team Celestial has been bringing basically every time they played Mage, yeah. They haven't brought Freeze Mage a single time, have not been performing that well. So, I guess it's kind of obvious. Freeze Mage is a good choice to bring. Minion-based mages, not so much. So if Team Celestial doesn't mix it up here and brings minion-based mages again, then I don't know. I don't like their chances.
Well, I hope he plays Control Mage for the time being. It looks like it's going to be Warrior versus Warrior. Wow, okay.
Mm-hmm. Most likely Patron versus Patron.
Yeah, you can pretty much expect both those players to bring Patron, Warrior. Oskaka and Tiddler have been known for playing Patron a lot in tournaments. And not so much the control warrior.
I have to say that back to the freeze mage discussion, I think it's just one of the most enjoyable decks to see play because you have so much flexibility in what you can do, and often the decision making is not realized until several turns down the line. And I feel it's perhaps one of the decks that you learn so much more from watching someone else play than actually playing it yourself.
Yeah, I agree with that. Well, you can just, if you actually go through the VOD backwards, you can tell what he was setting up. Like, I've seen some plays that you wouldn't believe were being set up like six turns ahead of time, but then if you actually watch the VOD, it's pretty impressive, some of the high-level freeze mage play.
Mm. In terms of the patron mirrors, they're also pretty funny. I think yeah. I think a lot of the ones that I have seen in the past have resulted in one player having a spectacular turn but roping out and then the other player winning. So I don't know if it's a good thing to like open up with the patrons to start.
Well, we've seen two of those upstarts I think in the league so far, like two missed lethals on patron because of the rope and then it just turned around.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably a better choice to bring Patron early, because if you get that word early, then you don't face the pressure as much as playing the Patron Warrior late when you're like on. I mean, we've seen some pretty spectacular scenarios where, oh yeah, the only deck remaining is Patron, but then it like keeps losing and losing and losing, and the pressure is getting bigger and bigger. And the more pressure you have, the harder it is to pilot this deck, obviously, because Patron. You don't have much time to think about your plays, and if your thoughts are somewhere else besides the gameplay, then your chances of losing drastically go up.
Yeah,
it's a very demanding deck indeed.
I wonder if we'll see, because I saw Silent Storm bringing a priest up, and you know there hasn't been much priest being played, and I'd like to see kind of a freeze priest variant. That's been a lot of fun to watch. Firebat was playing it a lot recently. Of course, not in tournaments, but you never know what Silent Storm could bring.
Now, I have seen the Grim Patron Warrior played generally in two type of ways in the mirror. In one way, it's just played kind of standard, but in the other way, you use combo pieces to initiate a lot of draw. What do you think maybe works a little bit better in the mirror, Ika?
Well, I feel like being able to draw your deck very, very fast is one of the keys to win this matchup, because often enough it comes down to the Frothing Burst and like making it cheaper with the Thorisen. The Patron, obviously going for a quick Patron turn, for being the one who gets the Patrons out first is obviously a huge factor, but if your opponent's able to handle it, then it all comes down to who draws the most cards.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And speaking of obscene Patron turn, we're about to see one possibly from a Skaka if he wants to rush for it, and there's no reason not to against a Warrior. Because unless they have unless they have a double execute plus weapon hit plus slam, you're usually gonna keep those, and that would be a huge resource investment anyway.
Alright, well, right away, this is pretty hard to clear here.
Yeah, this is as good of a Patron turn as it gets. Deathbite into Inner Rage, I mean, this is very hard to deal with, but Tiddler has a lot of cards in his hand, so let's see what his best options are. Not too much to clear everything, I think, right there. There's Execute and no Slam, unfortunately. Well, I thought there would be a Slam, maybe.
Well, I think he's still fine, because, you know, the 5-1 dies to the Whirlwind effect, and the other one could die to the second weapon that he could get. So what I'm curious about is, what Askaka's follow-up is, if... Wow. Okay. No, I was going to say, doesn't work out...
that card sucks.
No, no play. No playing on Patron. You don't like playing it onto more Patrons?
No.
Grip, tell me how the Patron wrecked you.
Well, I don't actually play too many Patrons. I play Constructed. I don't play too much Constructed. So when I do, it's usually not Patron. And when it is, it's played badly enough that I can win with anything.
Yeah. I know exactly the players you're talking about. You know, that rank 14 sweet spot of cool decks. Up to like rank 6. That's patrons, right there, it's amazing.
Alright, well, things are looking pretty grim right now.
Yeah, it's a really tough spot for Tiddler to be in.
He would basically need to get his Patron top deck next turn to get his own Patron wave going, right? Because he could do it. He could counter clear very easily if he picks up a Patron off the top, because he's got the coin.
Oh, there it is.
I was actually thinking the card there needs is probably like Emperor, because if he gets Emperor, he can just kill his Kaka with Frothings.
Right. Yeah. That's a great point, actually. Back to work.
Alright.
Yeah. He tanks 4 damage, like 5 damage, I guess, which is the reason why he played it. Not so much. I don't think he's afraid of Patron spawns anyway, because he can counter them so easily.
Okay. What can we make of this? I feel like the ghoul hitting into the Cruel Task is just quite nice. Maybe even charging and frothing the face. Actually, how much damage is that?
I was going to ask, like, how much damage is Warzone Commander Frothing trade the 1-1 and then get, what, 4 activations plus 2 damage? So that's, like, 6.
Not lethal, but it's very,
yeah,
very
it's
close.
It's 10 damage, and, yeah, that's pretty sweet.
Is it not lethal? Are you sure?
Crypt doesn't believe. If there's a Frothing and it's charging, it's probably killing. No, it's not quite there, but it would have been really close.
Alright, looks like he's going to do the Dread Corsair play.
That's really smart of Oskaka, because this way the ghoul cannot enable Tiddler's patrons that you might have planned to put out, and now Tiddler's in a bad spot, because even charging the patrons won't allow him to go through the Corsair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Oskaka had to attack with the ghoul into a minion here no matter what, because he just needed to minimize the outs that Tiddler has, which includes basically his own board.
Well, now...
So even putting out the taunt to maximize playing around potential frothing charges or grim patrons, basically.
Well, Frothings do a lot of damage, but they don't do that much damage. not in this situation. I actually don't see how Tiddler's supposed to stay alive. Am I missing something?
No, there's nothing there. There's absolutely nothing there.
Okay.
He's playing out the cards. And he's giving information away. You don't show that you've got a whirlwind in your patron deck.
What is that? Or execute, right?
Right.
Unheard of.
The day we see Crush is the day that my life is switched upside down. Yeah, could you believe that injured Valdir might make it see play? That'd be fun. Well, Tiddler goes down, and Forsen boys are still taking another win.
Yeah, and we're in that situation again where, I'm not so sure Team Celestial can lose another game here to stay in the tournament. So, man, that's a tough spot. Who handles the pressure now? I mean, Soundstorm couldn't take it. Soundstorm almost took it. I mean, it took almost a miracle for Chucky to win that game, but he did. And didn't recover for Tiddler at all. Is it Frozen Ice's turn? Is it all on him now?
Well, Frozen Ice, I would not put my hopes into him. I mean, after all, he has the worst win rate of all the players in the Archon Team League.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I mean, basically, Celestial needs a miracle to happen right now, and it's looking rather grim after this very unfortunate start into this series.
Yeah, it's really rough, actually, going 0-2 in your first two games. That's, like, even though they might have had hope at the end of the day, you know, last week they were like, yeah, maybe we can actually power through the teams next week. Let's get our best decks together and, you know, work this out. And they start the day, and the wins are actually pretty quick, which is unfortunate. Like, it doesn't drag on to fatigue and patron. It's just, like, a blowout.
The thing is, though, like, you don't want to, like, end, I think it's after 8 weeks total, without winning anything. Or is it 7? I think it's 7. You have to win one, right? Like, you have to get a point on the board.
Yeah, I could see that. I mean, it totally makes sense. It would be, you have to at least prove that, well, then again, Crip, isn't it more consistent if you just lose the last week? And you're just like, that was a bad event, let's write it off. You know, like, it doesn't count, right? You don't tally it. You have to put 1 point.
Yeah.
I feel like the one point is for effort. I don't know. Okay. He cut.
I mean, going 0-7 is kind of an embarrassment, so you need to, like, at least save face a little bit.
Yeah.
You have to go Mogashan Warden style, right?
Well, it would be 1-6, so no, not exactly.
The one they do 8 weeks total?
No, it's 7 because you play 7 weeks, you're right. Teams, right? There's 18? Yeah. Okay, you can't play yourself. If you play yourself, you would get a point. You would in fact, be the Mogashan Warden. You'd be right. But no, not quite this tournament. Next up, I'm kind of hoping we'll see just a little bit from everyone. Kind of hoping we'll see Forsen versus Frozen Ice. Again, I have not seen Team Celestial play in a tournament so far. Somehow I've just kind of dodged all their games each week. And, as a result, I haven't seen Frozen Ice play. So I'm wanting to see some of his aggression that you guys have mentioned him for. It's kind of curious that aggressive decks, you guys said, haven't really worked in this tournament so far too well. At least not for him. Why do you think that is?
Well, in general, I mean, aggressive decks have been performing fairly well, I would say. The Hunter is with 59% win rate, the best performing class. And behind that is the Warlock. So Frozen Ice technically has the best performing classes. And so therefore, I don't know why he just doesn't perform that well as other players do, like me, for example.
Oh, damn.
Wow, the suffering indictment there, you go. It's fine. I mean, it's one of those things, I think, for Frozen Eyes, though, where it feels like he's more comfortable with the aggressive, and I think his aggressive Hunter deck has been the most aggressive we've seen in the event. We've seen a lot of hybrid, but he's been playing a lot of face, and that deck is known for its inconsistency in tournament play against players that know better how to navigate against it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this right here might be the start of a comeback for Celestial if this is the matchup I'm expecting. Mage Forsen has been bringing nothing but freeze mage basically,
right?
And Silent Storm with the Druid, of course, has a really good matchup against freeze mage, especially because he has Ragnaros in his deck.
Yeah, Ragnaros is one of those things that you can't even deal with if you're playing the mage. How favored do you think the Druid is just in the standard non-Ragnaros list? Because I don't think it's that favored. It's probably like 60s
Honestly, I've been losing, like when I was playing Freeze Mage on ladder, I've been losing more games to Druid than to Control Warrior. Mm-hmm. And that's saying something.
Yeah.
Druid's matchup against Freeze Mage is really, really good.
Okay. All right, well, it is Freeze Mage. It's a fair hand from the Mage if Forsen can pick up some card draw. I think it'll work out pretty well for him, and I think it's pretty likely that's going to happen, as most of his deck is card draw.
Yeah, there's like no cure on Silent Storm's side, though, which is a bit of an issue, because in this matchup, I feel like a lot of the wins come out from one blowout turn where you get either a sick board lock with Lotheb or really early ramp with the Powdered Shredders out as fast as possible.
Mm-hmm. Forsen plays out the Ice Barrier, the Ice Block to guarantee the Ice Barrier off the Mad Scientist. Seems fine.
Yeah, definitely a strong play. You don't want your hand to be clogged up with too many dead cards. If he gets that Ice Block into play through the Scientist, then yeah, he has one card less to play with, basically.
Well, you really don't need to remove the Mad Scientist off the board. Not this turn, at least. So, you swipe face.
Well, already going for it. I think you can keep Swipe and Wrath for the Doomsayers that you have to expect. It's one of the few combination of plays that you've got in this matchup that allow you to clear it off. But I kind of like Sunstorm's position. Like, by not unstealthing the Shade, it gives him the ability to keep the Shade on 2 health if he wants to kill the Mad Scientist. So that's going to put it out of ping range.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, this is an interesting play that Forsen just did, coining out the hero power just to draw a card with his Acolyte. With the Thorisen in hand, it seems kind of odd, like not being able to coin out the Thorisen, but the play he's setting up with basically is turn 5 Doomsayer into Frost Nova and then have a clear board for the Thorisen.
Yeah, and it's going to work all right. He's going to get another draw off the Acolyte as well. I don't really see a better play than that.
Nope. Well, what's your follow-up, though? Like, think about the fact that you don't have a Blizzard right now. What happens if there's a Keeper of the Grove to defuse the Doomsayer?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, never mind.
Yeah, well, it's just a leap of faith, basically. It's what you have to do in order to ahead.
So you don't kill the Mad Scientist because you could still lose the Doomsayer and then the Mad Scientist is useful again.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah, I think you gotta have faith in this deck. Quite a lot of the time,
especially in such a bad matchup. And when you're facing down a bad matchup in general, you have to go for risky plays, no matter what. You have to always like play the best case scenario in order to win.
Oh man, Forsen's about to get hit with Ragnaros next turn. Luckily for him, he's got the Fireball Frostbolt, and he's gonna get the Emperor initiative. So
yeah, Emperor's pretty good actually. I think it's really good if Ragnaros misses the Emperor. Right, because you got the Arcane Intellect, you got the Loot Hoarder, more stuff coming down.
If it misses, it might be almost too dangerous, but you don't really have the choice in Silent Storm's position.
I think you do.
Would you play here?
I feel like this was a pretty YOLO play playing the Rag here, because giving Freeze Mage Emperor for 2 turns is pretty backbreaking, actually.
Okay, so you would have swiped it and hero powered it, and they just played it very slowly and let him get, a bit more card draw after that.
Yeah, you kind of can do that. You have all the time in the world usually against Freeze Mage as the Druid. I don't know. I don't really like leaving the Emperor up because it gives the more cheap cards the Freeze Mage gets, the better the combo potential becomes with Arcanist Nidus or stuff like that.
Fair enough.
What do you think about just Doomsayer there?
Another Doomsayer, Hail Mary, and see what it does. I mean, Rag has to kill it.
Oh, there it is.
I mean, Forsen is happy to extend the game, I guess, beyond its normal duration. But at the same time, he doesn't really have all he wants. Ooh, that's a pretty nice Wrath pickup, though.
Yeah, the Wrath allows him to basically... Can he clear everything? No, he's one mana short of that, isn't he?
Well, actually, if he wants to swipe the Doomsayer,
he's gonna have to swipe. He's gonna have to swipe the Doomsayer Wrath of Doomsayer and Hero Power down the Mad Scientist, I believe. And just go for the 50-50 again.
Yep. With another turn of potential reduction on Thorsen.
Is there anything else?
Actually, wait. What about Swipe Emperor, Wrath Emperor, Hero Power down Mad Scientist, and hope Rag kills a Doomsayer, and if it doesn't, it goes face, and it's still fine? Because that way, Emperor is guaranteed to go off, right? Okay.
Yeah, it's
was that what you're going to say, Cop?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically, it basically comes down to what do you fear more, the Doomsayer killing the Rag or the Emperor proccing one more time and dealing 5 damage?
It looks like he's going for a similar play here. By leaving the 50-50 on the Doomsayer or face. Goes face. But the idea there was that he didn't take 5 damage, right?
Well, he could have wrathed it for card draw, right?
Oh, he could have wrathed it and it'll take him 2. You're right.
Yeah. Well, he opted for a different line of play. I think it's ultimately pretty valid anyway.
Yeah, it's okay. Speak to me. I think I prefer. I prefer saving the Druid of the Claw, though.
Yeah, Druid of the Claw, not saving that one was really odd. Like, what do you need the Wrath for, honestly?
As you know, Krip said earlier, you know, he asked, what do you think, Ecop? Do you think at some point morale is down in the dumpster and you don't really want to try as much? Maybe it's a case of that, or just he missed the play because he was looking at the Doomsayer with the Swipe and Wrath and then switched to the last plan too late.
Alright, well, you are able to Lothab Shade and Innervate Hero Power here. And I like that play, I think, the best. Shuts out a lot of options.
Silent Storm doesn't end up getting punished for that. Usually, Lothab, playing Lothab on the turn where Mage is about to get the 9th mana crystal for Alexstrasza is pretty brutal. But fortunately for Silent Storm, Forsen doesn't have the Alexstrasza.
Ooh, Archmage.
Yeah, but he does have the Frost Nova for 6, and then he can ping his Acolyte to draw even more if he wants to. Although, I think Silent Storm's not quite out of it. It's just that going through... Like, I think surviving is going to be the biggest issue very soon.
Well, he doesn't die to the board because he has Ice Barrier. I think you can just slam down Antonitis.
Would you just... What about Fireballing Lothab? Maybe not. Oh... Well, that's a convenient top deck. So back-to-back Blizzard Flamestrike, that should take care of just about anything.
Yeah. Well, Flamestrike alone just takes care of anything at this point in the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there aren't exactly bigger minions than 5 health anyway. From wow, nice top deck there, Soundstorm.
That sucks.
Whoa,
I mean, it's still alright, considering he's going to draw cards of Ancient of Lore.
I mean, Force of Nature at any point... Can't even pop the Ice Barrier, so that's the issue he's running into. He's going through 8 health and then possibly another 8. You have to assume your opponent's got the second one at this point after drawing it their entire deck. It's a lot.
Well, I think that Ice Barrier pop is okay, because if you can pop the block, you're probably gonna push for lethal with Swipe now. Sometimes you don't want to pop that Ice Barrier because you don't want to see another one come down, right?
So, I have one question. Does Forsen have an offensive play? So, if you go Archmage, Frostbolt, Frostbolt, Icelands, can you win on the back of that next turn? Because you've got a Fireball for 2 and 2 more Fireballs, so you have 18 on the following turn.
Yeah, that's what he's thinking.
He's counting it up. I mean, he's looking through his cards, looking through the damage he can put out in the matter of 2 turns. But I don't think it's quite enough. 24 health is a lot, after all. We will see the safe Flame Strike right here.
Well, he has 28. The problem is that another Ancient of Lore loses in the game, because he's going to be one-off lethal, and then he's going to have to start playing very slowly.
Mm-hmm.
If you Frostbolt face, you're playing around Force of Nature Savage Roar.
Yeah, for it not to break your block. I like it. Now Soundstorm needs more than just combo to pass through the block. He doesn't even have combo, but it's alright. I think Shredder Sylvanas is strong enough. Often you don't want to play Sylvanas because of the fireball risk when you play a Doomsayer, but I think with just the Shredder on the board, it's not that big of a deal. Apparently it is, though.
I guess he really wants to make sure it gets value, but what are you going to get value of at this point? There's little that's going to be really threatened by Sylvanas ever, because the moment you play her is to steal something like Archmage, and if Archmage is on the board, Sylvanas is too late.
Yeah, now Archmage with Frostbolt Ice Dance, giving Force and two Fireballs, which basically signifies 18 damage.
There's no way Soundstorm can stay alive here.
Tree of Life. let's be real.
And Forsen with the emotes, classic Forsen right there.
And Soundstorm smiling at it, because, you know, he doesn't really mind at this point.
Even if Soundstorm had played the Sylvanas, he would have had three Fireballs, the Innervate, but Forsen still has the Ice Block. Really, the only thing Forsen could have even be bothered to worry about, I think, was maybe Kazan Mystic, but I think that's not very common in Druid, as you guys already talked about. You already counter Freeze Mage pretty well.
I mean, this is kind of brutal, but it is a deserved victory for Forsen, in my opinion, because Sandstorm did not choose to clear that Thorsen as soon as it hit the board, and this basically allowed Forsen to get into those scenarios, which we see right now.
Mm-hmm.
And Sandstorm's gonna die exactly to the fireballs that Archmage gave, no need for that other one at 2 mana, so...
But we should credit his good play at the end there to pop out the Shredder. Because if you get, I think, a Vitality Totem, you don't die to the double Fireball that you know is in hand, right?
You're right. He could have lived just short of it. What if
for,
one day we
for
get...
What he knew,
right,
for what he knew.
Right. But I wonder one day if we'll get like a 2-mana card that's going to deny spell play. You know, kind of a mini Lothab.
Maybe like a Grounding Totem, right?
Right. So you get that and then Freeze Mage is, you know, facing off 6 damage into it.
I don't know. Freeze Mage is a deck that doesn't really get kicked out of the meta too frequently, and when it does, it usually comes back in shortly after. All right, well, Foursome Boys is up to a commanding lead. We have seen this quite frequently in the Archon League in the past, where one team gets like 2 or 3 points on the board, but it's that moment where you have to seal out the last few points that's really relevant in most matchups. However, with Team Celestial requiring 2 crushing victories to stay in the tournament, it looks like that's not going to happen.
Yeah, I wonder if they go 6-3 right now. Like, if they just completely reverse sweep Forsen Boys, if they could do it. I'd have to actually go back through the numbers, but I suspect it might be already too late at 0-3. Ikop, do you have the exact numbers? Because I'm not too sure on it.
It's going to be rough. I mean, let's say Forsen Boys get reverse swept now 6-0, then it's going to be 6-3. And this will mean that... Oh, man. Wait a second. I have it in front of me right here. Forsen Boys would have, like, 27 wins, and Team Celestial would be at 24 wins. So, basically, Celestial would need to win... win again, so 6 more wins, and Forsen Boys would need to lose and have 3 wins once again within their next defeat.
Well, then it's still possible. We'll see if Frozen Ice can actually take the game against Forsen. What decks has Forsen been playing the most so far? Like, when he brings Warlock, what do you expect from him, Mika?
Definitely Zoo. Forsen has been playing Zoo, like, basically, every time he's playing Warlock, whenever I see him on stream, he's playing Zoo, and definitely a deck that he's very comfortable with, and obviously a very powerful deck. After all, Warlock has been having a very high win rate, 55% overall, and I think it's only been dragged down by Handlocks, honestly. Handlocks have been performing very poorly, and so without counting Handlock, Zoo has actually an even better win rate than 55%.
We've also seen Dragon Handlock, and at least for the matches that I participated in casting, the Dragon Handlock was doing pretty well as well. So why do you think Handlock is doing so poorly these days?
Well, it's hard to say. I mean, the popularity of Hunter and...
Even Freeze Mage, I think, is a problem, right? Like, it's another matchup that they've got that isn't really that bad for Mage.
Yeah, even something as like Patron Warrior, which often enough people, like, everyone says that Handlock is favored against Patron Warrior. Patron Warrior can still win that matchup as well. because just because it's Patron Warrior and can beat everything.
Well, it's got people have gotten a lot better at playing it as well. So it used to be the case that people just looked at Handlock and figured, well, that's an auto loss when I'm playing Patron. But now I think they've learned when to keep their bursts and they're playing it a little bit more accurately, I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we have the Zoo versus Hunter. I think players who played ladder are pretty familiar with this kind of matchup. Yep.
Not a great moment. I think Forsen's actually not doing so well right now.
It's largely Forsen because of that Unleash the Hounds, I believe, though. It's always
the Forsen
big swing.
Has some of those key components which are really necessary to beat, especially a Face Hunter with a Void Core that can give you Mal'Ganis and also the Defender of Argus. But it's going to be really tough. I mean, especially with the Taffer on the board right now, so much damage going to the face, and Forsen under a lot of pressure right now.
How many imps? 2 imps.
I mean, it doesn't really matter since you can basically subtract them from the Unleash play that's coming right up. So if it had gotten 5, I guess, they would have still
died. It's actually good to have a lower result because the Unleash, the Hounds might even go face. Who knows?
No, man.
I'm actually surprised that it is not going face.
Okay, so you would have gone face there, Crip.
Yeah, well, yeah. maybe because he wanted to play around Defender of Argus.
That was just so much damage, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I mean, many players would have gone face there as well, I would think.
Do you play the Flame Imp?
Well, you have to kind of vomit the bad demons out of your hand, right?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, your only hope is maybe getting Mal'Ganis and then play Doomguard. And even then, like, you know, Owl's just around the corner. So it's always very sketchy. See, we see Frozen Ice again bringing an aggressive variant on Hunter. Like, no surprise. No switch deck-wise. It's all very, very consistent with his previous weeks.
All right. Well, I don't think he looked at the trap, so I guess we know what that is.
Explosive. That's my bet. I'm betting his explosive trap.
Oh, no way. Come on.
What? You don't believe? I'm telling you, Frozen Ice is only playing that. Oh, wow. Never mind.
Yeah.
Noxious Slide.
Alright, well, that's going to be it. Forsen's going to make a pretty desperate play here. Of course, it's the only play he can make, and then Frozen Ice over the top with a kill command, starting what perhaps might be a reverse sweep? Probably not.
And Forsen rolling his eyes. He's like, yeah, of course, kill command. You know, it's kind of funny. I think Forsen's one of the players I like to look at the most when he plays.
Yeah, Forsen likes to get salty a lot.
Almost like dominance.
It's intended. Yeah.
Yeah, very, very decisive victory. That class does not go away. Probably not even with the new expansion. But pretty interesting stuff. Not too much play, I feel. That was just a matter of circumstance that led to Forsen losing. So a bit unfortunate for him. But Team Celestial gets a point on the board. And they only need 5 more.
Yeah, just only 5. Just five. Back to back, mind you. So it's a pretty big feat. Then again, you know, you mentioned this earlier. We've been in a position like this before where one team gets the first few wins and then the other one just at least equalizes, sometimes takes it over them. So it's not impossible. But it's, you know, just the, like, just statistically, it's going to be really painful for Team Celestial. Even with good matchups.
Yeah. Yeah, it's quite a mountain to climb.
Especially with those classes that are kind of, I would even say, like, Celestial brought pretty bad classes to this tournament, to this match. Druid and Priest statistically have the worst win rates. And Silent Storm is playing them both. Like Priest on a 38% win rate and Druid on a 35% win rate.
Right.
Well, that's by far the worst ones.
Well, if you take, you know, in each team there seems to be that one guy who always gets, you know, that sixth deck. You have 5 decks that you're pretty comfortable picking. And then there's a 6th slot that you have to give to one guy. And Silent Storm so far in the league has been picking up those, you know, underdog decks that we've seen since week 1, pretty much. That's been the case. I remember week 1 he went with Shaman, I think, that he was playing. Then he had Paladin. And then he just kept on playing Paladin and Druids nonstop. So it's been a really, I guess, underdog series of games for Silent Storm since the start.
Oh, we will have to see how it all turns out.
What would you guys run with here?
Aggro Priest.
Aggro Priest?
No way.
Shadow Bombers. The dream. What have you got to lose, really? Right? Like, if you're Silent Storm, don't you just bring Malygos Velen Priest here? With double Light Bomb and...
Well, we've seen a lot of Priests. I'm kind of surprised that the win ratio for Priests has been as low as you mentioned, Ecop. Just in other side tournaments, it's been a pretty solid class in the Conquest format. I think maybe it's largely because a lot of players bring three aggressive decks to the Conquest format, and the Priest countering those reasonably well with some decks usually can pull out a win sometimes without too much difficulty.
Yeah, I mean, the win rate that Priest has in this tournament might be low, but it's not really representative because nobody's actually bringing Priest. Priest only has been played 8 times, and its stats are 3-5, so it's not really representative. On the other hand, Druid, though, has a pretty representative stat, 16 wins and 30 losses, so that's pretty significant, and I'm curious why people still bring Druid to the team league.
It's wild growth, man, wild growth. Haven't you heard, Ecop? Good players draw it.
Yeah. Alright, well, it's going to be Zoo against the Grim Patron again. Two losing decks facing off against one another. This is a fun matchup. This is a fun matchup, though, man.
You gotta give the edge to the Patron, though. I mean, all those small critters lying around on the Zoo's side of the board are just... Yeah, victims to the Patron with Warzone Commander. All that Tiddler basically needs is time to get to the mana he needs to go for the combo.
Well, he has a lot of stall cards, but he doesn't have any draw. And without that draw, that Emperor is pretty useless. So Tiddler's still looking for some cards. Forsen has a pretty good hand, but... I mean, this game is going to last a little bit longer here. Like, this warrior is going to hold off the Zoo aggression for many turns.
Oh, that's a bit awkward for Forsen, but at the same time, I guess, you can't really afford not, like, playing on curve just because you don't want to take out the Armorsmith. You have to make that power whelming trade. I mean, there's a chance the warrior doesn't have the extra bit of damage. Like, he doesn't... Like, at worst, he overrides his weapon with Deathspite or plays Cruel Task in a position like this.
Why do you think he chose to tap rather than play the Dougie? Don't you think you want to dump your hand if you have a Doomguard?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess he wanted more options. He just hopes to get the Doomguard off the Voidcaller.
I think he was playing around Cleave.
Cleave?
Yeah. Seems a bit unlikely.
Somebody in the chat believed it, so it's alright.
No, nobody believed that. Alright, well, Tiddler again struggling quite a bit. He's picked up a bit of card draw with the Acolyte, but he can't play it this turn. And, well, you can't really play much this turn.
Yeah.
This is actually interesting. He had the option of clearing the Voidcaller, and often enough it's decent to do that when the Voidcaller hits play on turn 4, because there is a chance that something like a smaller demon has been drawn on the same turn. Mm-hmm. And that's just something bad is going to enter play.
Okay, so you would have done that just in the hopes, because, you know, they don't keep, obviously, Mal'Ganis early on, so there's there's little chance that that happens. But even a Name Gang boss would be a bit of an issue, wouldn't it?
Well, much less of an issue than a Doomguard, though.
Yeah, we really have to think how disastrous it would have been if he dropped the Emperor there.
I don't really want to think about this. From his perspective, it would have been like a complete blowout.
Imp Gang, Doomguard.
Yeah.
And Forsen's still in really good shape, but I mean, the Grim Patron Warrior doesn't usually fear small minions if it has enough life, so...
Yeah, the problem for Taylor, though, is he's approaching the mana that he needs for the Warsong Patron combo, but he doesn't have the Warsong or the Patron.
Mm-hmm.
So... Taylor in a very tough spot. He needs to draw into those cards. as soon as possible.
All right. Well, he's got an execute for... Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, things just got real. Things just got real. So you can't kill your own 4-4, unfortunately.
Okay.
Do you play the Imp Gang boss here? Before you pop the ghoul? Well, I guess not.
Nah, because the imps would just die to the weapon anyway, right?
Yeah, the next AoE.
I guess it doesn't really matter to play that near the doggy because the doggy's dead to the death spite, but one can hope.
What? Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought that was. I was looking at this strategic reason behind that. I'm like, is because he took his time, so I figured there was a reasoning, but turns out it was just a mistake.
All right. Well.
Well, indeed.
If you get the Doomguard, you can execute it. I guess that's the idea. Nope. Guess not.
So he's just trying to get a bit of armor, wipe the board a bit cleaner, probably use Inner Rage and execute to kill... Well, just about everything else, actually. It's not quite over yet.
Now he's going with the Battle Rage. No execute.
Uh-oh.
That's kind of why he wanted to do that. And okay. That kind of makes sense. I think this is like the play to win.
Right.
Is he dead?
Not quite. He needs 3 more damage to win right there.
What if he gets...
Malganus.
Yeah.
You're right, actually.
15, and then you have 5, 2, and 1 plus 6. So you have... Oh, no, you're 1 off lethal, right? You're 1 off because of the armor that you gain killing off your Voidcaller.
Yeah, they gain 1 armor killing it off. That's kind of amusing, but... So, Tiddler still has a chance. A tub, like, if this armor smith doesn't die, which I'd be very surprised by. And even then, Warsong Commander, back-to-back, like, clear the entire board with patrons.
Alright, well, I guess the Mal'Ganis could have put him at 1 life, but now it's all but hopeless anyway, so who cares? Like, what are Grim Patrons gonna do now?
Yeah, you're out of mana. Well, I guess you could execute Mal'Ganis, but you can't even whirlwind anything, so...
Yeah. Looks like that's gonna be it.
Yeah, I was gonna say whirlwind, execute, and then get another whirlwind, but you don't have that effect. Actually, you can execute Mal'Ganis and the Doomguard, then you play the ghoul. Are you still alive?
He doesn't even execute the right one first. No, he
can't. Oh my yeah, god, that was a Tiddler.
Gotta execute the Doomguard first, or else it's just undamaged.
Oh.
And you can see him frown like, wait. Oh, yeah, no, Stormwind Champion. Oh, this is Frostbolt Warlord all over again.
Yeah. I mean, and Force and realizes and goes for the punish.
Yeah.
Pretty rough, man. Hurts?
How much does that hurt?
That hurts. You're right, he wasn't dead. And with a Grim Patron in hand, it's not really over. Could have got a war song.
Yeah, he could have actually, like, won this game. I think. There's a chance that he just won this afterwards. Okay, he is still...
He is still alive, isn't he?
Right. Yeah, he is.
Is that one?
Yeah. Still alive.
Bad card.
And still alive. Okay, Tiddler, you will live.
And yeah, now... like, what is a one card draw here that actually saves you?
There's nothing.
Warsong's the closest, but there's nothing that'll clear everything. Now that the execute is gone, this Doomguard's kind of here to stay.
Right.
Shield block, but now Lotheb fell, so you don't have the chance to cycle.
What about like a YOLO brawl? Just like tech choice, you know?
Oh man.
We see that would play Brawl in Patron, so.
Yeah.
But I doubt that Tiddler applied this tech to his deck.
Mm hmm. Alright, well, Forsen doesn't get benched. He instead cleans up here. I think Forsen is done for the day. He's got that green check mark. How good does it feel to get that?
It feels pretty good, especially early on, but then you still like have to. Hope that your teammates make it, because obviously it doesn't rely on yourself only.
Yeah. Do you stick around, by the way? Like, when you're done, do you stick around to talk with the teammates, or did you just kind of go off and do your thing since you've already talked everything through before the match has started?
Oh, of course, I stick around. I mean, anything to support my teammates, any small edge that we can get. I mean, I can like scout out my opponents and see what kind of tech cards they brought and just give my teammates advice on how they should approach this matchup, and everything helps, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think just when someone's just talking to you, trying to guide you, you kind of just get that little bit of confidence boost, yeah, which sometimes makes a little bit of a difference.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, if you know your opponents are your teammates are sticking around to support you, obviously you get that morality boost.
Yeah, you're not alone, I guess.
Aww.
Michael Jackson style. Oh God! All right, so.
Man, yeah, it is a pretty long journey home. I'd imagine Chalky is playing the up and coming aggro Pally and Rogue from Osaka. While I think we've seen Rogue not be particularly good in the tournament, if I'm not mistaken, but I know I've missed quite a few of the matches, so maybe I am mistaken on that. I feel like the Rogue just has a few good matchups here and there.
Yeah, Rogue actually probably is just like, get a win. Rogue is in the middle of the pack right now, kind of being the closest to a 50% win rate with 24 wins, 26 losses overall. So Rogue is kind of the middle ground. It's a safe deck. It can win against everything. It can also lose against everything, I suppose. And mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Rogue is definitely a good class to bring, but I guess it's just preference for a lot of teams. Some teams like Rogue a lot. Some teams don't like Rogue at all. So we've been seeing Rogue in and out of lineups.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what's really awkward about the class is, you know, all the decks that it's really great against simply aren't quite in the metagame at the moment. Say you really want to beat off, you know, all the priests and the paladins are all dead to the rogue player, but there's none of those in the metagame, really. So even warrior now has learned to play a lot more effectively. You see shield blocks being rotated back in. That gives the rogue a lot more difficulty burning through the armor, kind of like when you face off against control warrior. So rogue has been falling out of favor, and it's also exposed to the same weapon hate that warriors are right now.
I think, though, that it's still a favor still a favor matchup against patron, and still probably a favor matchup against zoo if you draw the right opening hand, and against most priest decks. So it has a few chances here.
Yeah, it's solid tier 2. Like, it's still somewhere like in the best decks, but I don't think it's time. I think against patron now it's gotten worse, like a lot worse than it used to be early. It came up as a counterplay to it, but it's kind of stabilized a lot. Well, we'll see Rogue versus Warrior, so yep. Turns out we'll see whether or not the Rogue is a good pick against it.
All right. That looked like a Deathspite keep from Tiddler. Seems interesting.
Well, Deathspite is definitely one of the key cards you want in pretty much every matchup when playing Patron Warrior, because it's like your main enabler for the patrons and also removal, like 2-for-1 removal at the same time. And against Rogue, that heavily relies on those mid-game minions to apply some pressure, to apply the most pressure actually from the rogue comes in form of minions. So a warrior definitely needs a way of dealing with them as soon as possible, because the more damage the minions can deal, the higher the chance is to just get burned out by cards like Blade Flurry and Eviscerate.
Now, what about this Fiery War Axe? As far as I know, most patron players have chosen to go down to one. But I think we've seen Tiddler draw into it every single game so far today.
Tiddler, I think, plays two. I've seen two last game, and it's kind of a nod towards aggressive decks, aggressive minion-based decks. You definitely need two Fire War Axes in that regard.
A little bit of an awkward turn here for the Rogue. A lot of combos, but nothing to unleash them on.
Yeah, prep, even like the thing is, even prep right now isn't that stellar. Like, there's no sprint. Your Vlad teacher is not here. It's like you have to coin out a Zerdrake, but that kind of forces a death bite of your opponent at least. That's one upside.
Mm-hmm.
I find it interesting that Tiddler not choose to attack with the with the Fire War Axe, because from, I guess he's expecting a Shredder, but let's say something like a Violet Teacher hits the board or an Azure Drake, then he definitely wants to have the Deathbite out. Or the Slowthep, for example. Like, what is Fire War Axe going to do against that? Pretty much nothing.
No, not too much, but maybe the Ghoul played defensively.
That's a bit awkward. That's actually really awkward from Tiller's position. The Slowthep is going to get some pretty sweet values. How do you play this if you're in Skullcrawl's position? Like, do you try to keep the Lotheb alive with Deadly Poison? Like, what's the...
Yeah. I mean, you also push for 5 damage, and a 5-1 is threatening enough. Is it Deadly Poison that you want to go with? You could also go with the Drake backstab.
Yeah, but the thing is, then the Drake takes damage. Actually, wait, no, you'd backstab first and attack with your weapon if you do that. That way your Drake doesn't take the 1 damage AoE and doesn't get executed, potentially.
I think it doesn't really matter if the Drake gets damage or not.
He goes for the sap. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's...
That's a sap.
This guy's toast.
Well,
that's really odd.
Sap,
it is really odd to see that, but yeah, then again, sap is kind of worthless in this matchup most of the time, so might as well sap something like that just to combo an SI.
Yeah.
But I feel like as a Drake might have been a better power play.
It does end up counterplaying here, as it would have given Tiddler the opportunity to play Emperor otherwise.
Now, will we see the Deadly?
Well, now your Lotheb dies to just the Death Rattle of the Death Spite, so you'd really only backstab here if you value the 5 face damage, and I think you might.
Yeah, definitely. The more minion, as I said before, the more damage your minions can put out to the face, the better it is. So you want Otsutaka just wants to maximize the damage that his minions can deal to the warrior. And they have dealt a lot of damage so far. I mean, Tiddler already at 15 health, and it looks like he will have to attack into this Azure Drake, so down to 11 he goes then.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult from Tiddler's perspective as well, because even though he does have the whirlwind effects, there's really nothing there to help him win the game. Like, he's just stalling, and you know that the rogue eventually is going to get that Tinker's Sharp Sword turn, maybe an Eviscerate turn, then, you know, Deadly Poison, Blade Flurries. And you're just going to take too much damage.
Alright, well, here comes Armorsmith. A bit of a defensive play. Actually, a really defensive play.
Yeah, it's very rough to, like, waste so many mana crystals that could have been otherwise used on Emperor. But, unfortunately, Tiller is in a spot where he needs to every point of health possible. Because he's
one off lethal now.
Otsutaka has him on the ropes.
Well, if you sprint into like a prep and like a Blade Flurry, you'll just win next turn almost no matter what. Otherwise, just push for damage and don't accomplish that much.
Or you pick up prep and still do pretty well.
You're 1 mana off lethal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
I'm actually not sure what to do.
And
we know every card in the situation.
I would probably kill the Armorsmith here most of the time and just re-dagger. Just because for him to kill the Azure Drake, he has to either smash into it with a second Deathbite or use Cruel Task Execute. You know, combination of cards, and then the Armorsmith's gone, so you might have time. Like, this doesn't enable patrons, so you're not really worried about... a turn like that just yet. No Emperor's been played, so...
Yeah, but what about Inner Rage, Whirlwind?
You pick up Blade Flurry. And then you hope that everything goes well.
Yeah.
That would have been lethal.
Alright, so he's got 4 from the weapon, 4 from Eviscerate, and 2 from SI. That is lethal. That puts Otsutaka as the point number 5 for Force and Boys.
Wow, that's
that
pretty
is
decisive
really brutal.
Victory for them.
Yeah, like, and now, I mean, Team Celestial, not only, even if they somehow get a miracle off and reverse sweep the Paladin of Chucky right now, it's still going to be tough for them to stay in the league overall, because they would need Forsten Boys to... I mean, Forsten Boys are pretty much safe, because they have so many game wins racked up already, thanks to this match particularly as well. So they are probably safe from elimination.
It is game wins versus game losses. I think if Team Celestial wins 6-5, they could still not end up last place, because Forsten Boys could get like 1/6, and then like Team Celestial can 6-1 the other team, because that would be a 10-point spread, right?
Right.
No, I think it doesn't matter how much how many games you lost. It only matters how many you win.
Okay, so they want to go 6-5 here, reverse sweep, and then win 6-1, and then they're like Forsten Boys has to go 1-6. So all the bad scores have to happen in the last week. Yeah, really unlikely stuff has to happen.
It is very unlikely that Forsten Boys, if they lose this one, that they will have a really bad score on the last week against Team Liquid. Basically, Celestial needs to hope that they win right now by some sort of miracle, and also that Team Liquid stumbles twice.
Yeah. Well, what can you do? Chalky is last up for Forsten Boys. If your last deck is Aggro Pally right now in the meta, that is a pretty good spot to be in. Oh, and Tiddler was benched across the face.
Well, yeah. Sandstorm is going to bring out the Paladin.
It really doesn't matter right now. Like, Forsten Boys has one deck.
They need to get the game wins, don't you? But I think this is actually the one situation where it doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. Yeah. In terms of like time efficiency, you send your worst matchup up there, because if you lose as a team against Forsten Boys, that puts you in a team record of 0-6 that cannot come back from last place.
Right. Well, I mean, Frozen Ice did put a point on the board here, so he did do his due diligence today. One win of the Face Hunter. We can craft him a Golden Hungry Crab, I guess, as a reward.
I don't know. I don't know if one win is really much to praise. You got to get the check mark, man. It's check mark or nothing.
Okay, so check mark for a Golden Hungry Crab.
Yeah.
I will craft it. If he gets the second win and the check mark, I will make a Golden Hungry Crab.
All right. The Golden Hungry Crab is a nice one. He has the claw animation.
Mm-hmm. Almost I might already have it, though. I'm not sure. Oh, snap.
All right. Well, as far as this matchup is concerned, it depends largely on the Priest deck. I think Priest with a lot of clears can do pretty well.
Yeah.
I think a Priest with Akanai Circle, if you draw Akanai Circle, is pretty devastating.
Wild Pyro is crazy good. That's the one thing in this matchup where we're assuming, of course, that Chucky's playing Aggro Pally. Like, if he is not, first of all, I'll eat my socks. And then there's a chance that this is, you know, possibly an even better matchup for the Priest player.
Well,
I don't think it actually matters what kind of Priest Sirenstorm has. I'm pretty sure that against an Aggro Pally, either build is going to be fine. Like, if you have the build with maybe a lot of Borg clears, including Pyromancer, then it's pretty good against all the one health minions that Paladin puts out. But also, if he has like a Deathlord priest, then the Deathlord alone is already pretty amazing, because Aggro Pally doesn't have a way of dealing with it properly.
All right.
Shaki is looking to get the shielded mini. Oh, he has a shielded mini bot.
Yeah, but I think he's going to have to juggler here to contest the. The zombie chow. Very sad state.
Power chill is so scary, but you kind of have to try.
Yeah, when you're playing an aggro deck, it's like, you know, if he has the perfect counter, I'm going to lose. But, you know, you have to take in some amount of risk with this deck. And, I mean, right now, even though this is pretty depressing for the aggro Pally, if we take a quick look at Sandstorm's hand, the next thing that he's playing is Cabal Shadow Priest in 4 turns.
Yeah, I mean, Shocky's gonna have a decent Divine Favor just because all those cards from Sandstorm are clogging his hand. Oh, the draw is one turn too late. Powered Shield, Sandstorm is like, why couldn't you be there just a little earlier? Oh, man.
Yeah, nothing is nothing is going right for Team Celestial this whole tournament, and this is like just one of many examples.
But yeah. You could get it on Blessing of Might, though. I mean, that's a Shadow or Death target, if not the only one, maybe, even in the Paladin deck.
Oh, wow. Arcane Golem. Well, we know the Blessing of Might on the Shield of Minibot is not going to work so well. So do you do Blessing of Might that, or do you just YOLO up with your Shield and Minibot?
I mean, I guess it's not that bad if you go...
Yeah. Oh, wow. Chucky actually goes for that.
There you go.
Shadow Madness isn't even that bad, because you keep the Shield and Minibot ultimately. Right. Wow, Soundstorm.
The punish. No, I think it's time. You're going to take the Shield and Minibot. I think you just double Power Word Shield it now. It's yours.
Yeah, no.
It's yours for the taking.
You know what, Crip? I love that play. He has to do it. Not only does that give him the Shield and Minibot being even better, but it's also going to give him card draw that he desperately needs at this point.
It's not.
this is unreal.
I guess he's saving the other one because he has a Wild Pyro. It is a very strong card with Wild Pyro, of course.
Mm-hmm. Shocky's got a lot of burst, though. Double Arcane Golem is definitely difficult to deal with.
True Silver Face, might as well. Soundstorm is not able to play anything so far. And it's turn 5. Can anything be played?
Yes!
Shadow Madness has been found. Not bad.
It's still not great.
So you Shadow Madness it, then you Power Shield it. And then you say that was a mistake, so he never suspects anything. And then you steal it.
Well, like, Shadow Madness isn't really that great because you're going to steal that Shield Minibot. Shadow Madness is actually considerably worse than Holy Smite there. Because right. Holy Smite, you can heal as well, and you keep the Divine Shield for yourself.
Well, so as long as he gets rid of pressure on the board, it's fine, yeah. I guess.
I guess.
It killed a 4-1. That's all that mattered, I guess, at this point. I don't know. I don't end up in a situation very often where I buff my enemy's minion because I plan to steal it 3 turns down the line. Usually I have something to play before then.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Chunky going with the mana feed. He knows that most things are going to cost 6 mana. So giving him a 7th mana crystal is not particularly relevant. Goes for the face hit, just in case he draws another weapon. Which he is pretty likely to do off the Divine Favor.
Interesting that he chose Hero
Pop
1-1 instead of the Argent Squire there, I think. Because if you get rid of the Argent Squire, you have not only a better minion, but also less cards in your hand for Divine Favor.
Mm.
Yeah, I think he plays too much Hunter, where you want to weave in that hero power too much.
Mm-hmm.
Or as much as you possibly can, realistically, so.
Alright, well, Chalky is 1 mana or 1 damage off of lethal here. But, I mean, the priest can heal for quite a bit, so you never know for sure.
The Holy Fire is kind of mandatory. I mean, Holy Nova would also put him out of immediate death.
What do you think about just Divine Favoring this turn? Just Squire, Divine Favor. I think I like it.
It's the most card draw you're going to get. Yeah.
It is pretty decent because you get the follow-up of Arcane Golem into Consecration.
Oh,
and
wow.
With the Abusive Sergeant here, you actually deal an additional 2 damage, which is pretty nice.
I don't even... Wow, okay, this hand is just giving me ulcers. These draws...
I mean, you mentioned Holy Fire, but does Holy Fire really do enough? Actually, yeah, it does.
Nova. Nova is actually exactly what Soundstorm wants. Little does he know, it does nothing, but it is going to give him hope.
Oh, it's actually it's...
7. Oh, it is enough.
Yeah, it is enough. To survive.
Yeah.
Once again, 1 damage off or 1 mana off.
1 damage off, 1 mana off.
Never mind.
Nope, that's enough. Oh, Arcane Golem okay. Kings.
Change of plans.
Got him.
6-1, second 6-1 in the entire league.
Team Celestial was looking for the 6-1 themselves. However, they found themselves on the other side of the table today, yet again. Well, in terms of the tournament standings, that puts Team Celestial guaranteed last and they are going to be the team that is eliminated. They will play again next week for funsies, I suppose. They can maybe deny a placement position for another team.
Right.
Also some, you know, maybe you can save some face, maybe getting a win, maybe a little bit. Okay, not really.
Yeah.
But hey, what can you do? Sometimes it doesn't work out for you. And in some of the games that we saw today, you know, luck had a pretty big factor.
You mentioned, you know, you want to get one win on the table. So they will try, at least, I guess, next week, if only to be, you know, for the sportsmanship factor. There's also the fact that in every single league or in every single big event like this, there always seems to be one team that just performs absolutely miserably. And not because their individual players are bad, but because somehow everything seems to line up against them.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, there's a lot of things that line up against them this time around. All right, guys. Well, that is going to be our first team matchup of the day. We will pause for a little bit here, take care of a few things. And coming up in not too long is going to be Team Archon versus Cloud9.
That's me.
Yeah. So we're going to have to kick you off here and wish you the best, ECOP. Good luck against Archon. I don't think Amaz will have quite as the best wishes as I had for you. I think he expects another team to win besides Cloud9. But we'll see. No, I'm just expecting some good Hearthstone.
Are you saying that Amaz is not partial? Is not impartial?
No, we didn't say that.
Nobody's truly impartial.
Right.
I'll say that. I'll be fair to everyone. All right, guys, before we head to the break, just a big shout-out to the sponsors, Alpha Draft and the Amazon App Store, letting this tournament take place. So good on them. They are running some promotions for you guys. So if you guys want to check out Alpha Draft, perhaps you can draft your fantasy team in the Archon Team League if you want, and you can win your share of $300,000 paid in cash every single week at Alpha Draft. They are the number one platform for fantasy esports, and you can sign up today for a $250 matching deposit bonus and get started on drafting your team today.
Yeah, do it. Big dollar.
All right, guys. We'll be back shortly, and I think we're going to get Amaz on the casting bench.
Yep.